So now let's go into the details of how to make your application competitive. As Jörg mentioned, many students apply for these awards, and only 2,000 every year win across all areas of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So how do you make your application competitive? Make sure you address both review criteria in both statements. Think about what counts as intellectual merit in your personal statement, again, your academic performance, grades, the classes that you've taken, as shown in your transcripts, or any awards or scholarships you may have gotten. The reviewers will look carefully at your graduate research plan, your two-page statement, and they're interested in how you motivate the question. Do you show any kind of sophistication about how you will try to answer it in terms of the methods? Are you naive, or do you have a sense of how science works? You might talk about how you'll know if your question's answered or what you might do if things don't turn out as you expect. And again, you can sketch briefly what you may do next. For broader impacts, they'll look at the whole package for that criterion as well. They'll look at your prior accomplishments, your future plans. Essentially, we're asking these reviewers to try to predict their future. Are you going to be a high-achieving scientist? Possibly the best predictor of the future is the past. If you can show a pattern of what you've done in the past and how that can predict what you're going to do in the future, that's a good thing. Even if you're changing research areas from your undergraduate to your graduate training, that's fine, but do convey the pattern of how you think and how you achieve that addresses your potential for impact on society. Your individual experiences and details here will be very important. Now, a few words about letters of reference. For your letters, make sure you select individuals who know you well, who may have mentored you, who can speak to your potential as a graduate student and new researcher and assessing your abilities when they write your letter. It's a really good idea to educate your letter writers about the Graduate Research Fellowship Program if they're not already familiar with it. Educate them about the criteria, intellectual merit and broader impacts, and ask them if they can address these criteria on your behalf. It's a really good idea to share your research and personal statements with your letter writers, because that way they can be prompted for any experiences that they've had with you. And again, you may even want to ask different letter writers to address different parts of your application. Now, a complete application includes three letters of reference, but you can list up to five just in case. Since you're not the one who submits these, when they get submitted is not entirely under your control. So if you list four or five, that makes it more likely that you'll have the three that you need to be received by NSF before the deadline. You should rank the letter writers if you list more than three, and you can change that ranking right up until the deadline. NSF will look only at the top three ranked letter writers in your package. Now, do keep in mind that the solicitation is the official word on deadlines of all sorts. This three-year solicitation has the letter writer deadline as the first Thursday in November. And again, it's 5 p.m. Eastern Time. So now let's talk about the review process. As you prepare your application, keep in mind your audience, which is composed of the reviewers within the field of study that you've selected, plus NSF. When you choose your field of study, look carefully at the other related fields that are included along with yours that will be looked at by your panel. Your materials will need to be understandable to all of the expert panelists assigned to review your application. Although they're all experts, it's very likely that some of them won't be researchers in your particular topic. So be very careful not to assume that the reviewers will all understand the jargon that's common in your field. Your application is assigned to a particular panel based on the field of study that you chose, but I know some of you may find this to be a tough choice if you're interdisciplinary. You may have a quandary in terms of which field of study to choose. You could ask your letter writers or your advisors for advice on that, but again, think about what kind of panel is most likely to find your topic and your field of study interesting, worthy, and that kind of thing. That could give you some input in your decision in terms of which panel to choose from if you have more than one choice. It's also a very good idea to select the primary field of study that's most closely aligned with the kind of graduate training in the program that you're joining or that you're already in. For some of you, again, that's obvious and easy, and for others, it may be trickier. So do look at the website and do consult with your advisors. So the panels conduct what we think of as holistic review. Holistic review is a flexible, individualized way of assessing your interests and competencies by which balanced consideration is given to experiences, attributes, academic achievements, and when considered in combination, how you've demonstrated potential for significant achievement in science and engineering. So panelists aren't actually counting things. They're looking at the big picture of you, and they're thinking about what use have you made of the opportunities available to you. The reviewers are asked by NSF to use the two foundation-wide review criteria to look holistically at each and every part of your application. This includes everything you submit, not just the list of experiences, but the personal information and awards and all of that, and then both of your statements and your transcripts and your letters of recommendation. You will receive written comments from the reviewers as well, specific to your application for both intellectual merit and then a separate set of comments for broader impacts and then a summary statement. And again, the qualitative ratings that you'll receive will be E for excellent, V for very good, G for good, F for fair, or P for poor. So before you begin your applications, do start by asking yourself, what is special, unique, distinctive, or impressive about you and your life story? Certainly, when you write your personal statement, you want your audience to feel like they know a little bit about you, that they understand what makes you potentially a high-potential scientist. You might also discuss details of your life that might help the reviewers better understand what motivates you, what makes you tick, and what makes you different from other applicants. Keep in mind that they're reading a lot of applications. Think about conveying, make sure you've conveyed when you actually became interested and committed to your field and when you learned about it and how. And what was it about yourself that convinced you were particularly well matched to the field that you're entering? Think about whether it makes sense to convey what you've learned about the field through classes, readings, independent study, seminars, other kinds of experiences, or by being inspired by people in the field or experience you've had. Any of these things could contribute to your personal story. And what reason in general can you give the reviewers, the panelists, and NSF to be interested in supporting you in this fellowship? Just to sum up, some advice. Start early. Well, that's easier said than done sometimes, but it really is a good idea to start early and not have to rush through this because the GRFP fellowship has wonderful benefits that can really change your life as a graduate student. You should read the solicitation and read it again. It's a good idea to peruse the Graduate Research Fellowship Program's website. We have a website with lots of examples of other fellows and what they've done, their achievements. And you can see the kinds of details that I've covered partly in these remarks. As I've mentioned before, be as clear as you can for the reviewers. Give them enough context. Connect the dots for them. Keep in mind that even though they're experts in your field, they're not working on the same topics that you are working in. So you need to frame everything so that a scientist who isn't doing exactly what you're doing can follow. Pay a lot of attention to the merit review criteria. It's a good idea to make this findable for the reviewers, have headings about your intellectual merit and broader impacts in both of your statements. Make it easy for the reviewers. Another reason to start early is so that you have time to ask multiple colleagues to comment on your statement drafts. Make sure everything's clear to them. Also, select and confirm your letter writers early. Make sure you've set up a way to remind them as the deadline approaches. And again, if you think it will help them, you can share your statements with them. You can also monitor the receipt of their letters on the website as the deadline approaches. So now Jörg and I will tell you about some resources that you can use as you prepare your application.
I would like to point out two websites. The first one is the official NSF website, nsf.gov/GRFP. There you will find the solicitation. NSFGRFP.org features videos and additional material which will help you with crafting a competitive application package.
And to look forward, you could take a look at the Grip and Grow parts of the website. These have to do with the additional funding opportunities available to our fellows. GROW, or Graduate Research Opportunities Worldwide, and GRIP, Graduate Research Internship Program, list the federal agencies in which some of our fellows work, as well as the foreign countries in which they can do research.
If you have any questions, please feel free to contact us by email or phone. Best of luck with your GRFP application.
Good luck.